Bible, turn with me to James chapter 3. James chapter 3. Last week we were talking about controlling your speech. Now, this is part two of that. We started the lens principle. I ask you to think about it because we're going to cover that in depth today. James chapter 3. We're going to read just verses 3 through 13, not the entire chapter like we did last week. James chapter 3, verse 3. He says here, "Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith, or with the tongue, bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God." He's telling us that man is made after the image of God. Therefore, we ought to treat man with respect. All right, verse 10. "Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessings and cursings. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? No. Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, even a vine, figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom." Last week, we read the entire chapter of this, speaking on the tongue. We are talking about that we are responsible for the words that come out of our mouth. This passage illustrates that even nature declares, it reveals that you can't have opposites coming from the same source. From our mouth, from a fountain, do you get both salt water and fresh? No, you don't. Different types of plants don't yield two different types of berries. They all yield the same thing, and it's comparing with our mouth. We talked about an old phrase that was used during World War II. The Department of War Information had posters all over the place that said, "Loose lips sink ships." They were trying to inform us or warn people of the unguarded tongue. In other words, put a guard about your tongue. And so we need to keep that in mind. Our tongue, our mouth, has such potential. It can do one or two things. It has such an impact on other people's lives by what we say. We talked about the different types of tongues last week. We talked about the untamed tongue, a person who has no control of whatever comes out of their mouth. In other words, what they think, that's what comes out. I gave you a couple verses. Proverbs 29:11 says, "A fool uttereth all his mind, but a wise man keepeth it in till afterwards." Another verse was Proverbs 17:28. It says, "Even a fool, when he holdeth his peace, is counted wise. He that shutteth his lips is esteemed a man of understanding." So we see a couple of verses where just a fool, he just speaks it out. If it enters his mind, it comes out of his mouth. We don't want to be fools. But even a person who's considered to be a foolish person, if he watches what he says and closes his mouth, can be considered to be a wise person. That encourages all of us to sometimes consider what we're thinking. If you think it, doesn't necessarily you ought to say it. Use wisdom before we open our mouth. We talked about a fiery tongue. This tongue does not put out fires. It starts fires. It causes friction and contention. It takes a problem and it magnifies the problem because the tongue opens its mouth and it speaks when it shouldn't be. It creates anger and frustration. I often tell people that in any given situation, you can consider yourself carrying two buckets. In one hand, you have a bucket of water. Water can put out fires. Or in the other hand, you have a bucket of gasoline. You throw gasoline on a fire and it intensifies the problem. And it's a matter of choice. Which one are you going to put on the fire, water or gasoline? And that's a choice you have to make. I also shared a verse last week, Proverbs 15:1, where it says, "A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. And I've practiced this many times when people are upset, they're angry and they're yelling, the level of their voice is way up here. And as they're talking, they're throwing out things that they really don't mean. And I'll say something like this, "You don't really mean that, do you?" It's that soft answer. It catches their attention immediately. "You don't really mean that, do you?" And it causes them to stop. Because where'd you get that? The Bible. A soft answer turns away wrath. I could answer back with grievous words. "Well, if you think that, I'll tell you what I think." Ooh, grievous words. It elevates things. So we need to, when there's a situation that maybe you're involved in, if you have the ability to quench it with a soft answer, try it. See how it works. That's God's word. We talked about a scornful tongue. The word scorn or scornful means to scoff or mock at, contempt or disdain. It's an expression of an attitude of speech that communicates someone is despicable or unworthy. And so we need to be careful that we're not a scornful person or a person with a scornful tongue. They're showing discontent. They're showing that they just do not like that thing or that person. We talked about the lying tongue. Zechariah 8:16 says, "Speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor." You know, even if it hurts, sometimes we just use wisdom and not say what we think. I had a friend would tell me, "Do you really want me to answer that?" Because I knew he was going to always speak the truth. We talked about the deceitful tongue. Proverbs 34:13, "Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile." Guile is a word that shows deceit. It means crafty or artful deception. Deceitful and cunning in attaining a goal. Deceitful speech, fraud, dishonesty. The deceitful use of words in order to hide or deceive. It's like, "Well, I didn't really say I didn't go, but the words they used led you to believe that they went." So on, you know. That's called guile. Politicians use guile all the time. It's the use of words. And to trick and deceive. They lead people to believing something other than what the truth is. Last week we started over what's called the lens principles. And so one of the principles in this that I stated is who we are determines how we see other people. That's the lens principles. And as we were speaking earlier, all of your background from a child and on up creates who you are. And believe me, some of us, I do not like who I used to be. I do not like what I had become, even into my early adult life. And God just brought people my way to teach me and train me differently. But the biggest thing that helped me in my life was receiving Christ as my Savior. And that gave me a whole new heart and a whole new outlook. But much of our speech is determined by the influence of our past, how we view ourselves. And I gave you the verse, if you need to write it down, it's Titus 1:15. Titus 1:15 says, "Unto the pure, all things are pure. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure." That means you listen to a person's speech. Are they positive? Are they negative? Are they perverted? I hate being around people. I've worked in the shops. You guys work in the shops. You know what it's like. There's people that you work, everything that they say, they've got a perverted twist to it. Oh, I despise that. Even in colleges, they've got that all over the place where they put a perverted twist to everything. You say something, you're innocent, you're not meaning anything perverted about it, and then they give you the look and they say something and they chuckle about it and you realize, oh man, I hate talking to you. You know, because that's because they're perverted themselves. And so they assume that you're like that. We ask the question, why is a person so critical and scornful of others? How can a person be so condemning and show such disdain and unworthiness in other people? It's because that person feels that he is unworthy with himself because of things that have happened in their past. What he sees in others is a picture of what he is within himself. An insecure person is insecure in all of their life, and that's all they see is insecurities. Who he is determines how he sees others. For instance, a pure person sees others as pure. A nice guy sees others as nice. A critical person sees all the flaws in everybody else. A defiled person sees everyone else like he is, defiled and polluted. A liar thinks everyone else is a liar. The way we see people is influenced by who we are on the inside. I shared a story about a traveler nearing a great city. He asked an old man seated by the road, "What are the people like in the city?" The old man says, "Well, what were they like where you came from?" And the man says, "Well, they were horrible, mean, untrustworthy, despicable, detestable in all respects." The old man said, "Well, you're going to find the people in this city the same way." Because of the lenses that man was looking through, he saw everybody like that. Not long after that, the first traveler had gone away. Another guy stopped in to inquire about the people in the city. He asked the old man the same question. The old man asked, "Well, what were they like where you came from?" He said, "Oh, they're fine people, nice, honest, industrious, generous to a fault. I was sorry that I had to leave." And the old man says, "That's exactly how you're going to find them here." Isn't that amazing? Sometimes we're so critical of other people, and it's because of what's inside here. We view them, we magnify them in the lens of our own eyes, and we got to be careful of that. Romans chapter 2 has a solution for that. The way we see others is a reflection of themselves. If I'm a trusting person, I will see other people as trustworthy. If I'm a critical person, I will see others. I will see all of their flaws, all of their faults, and them being as critical. If I'm a caring person, I will see others as compassionate because of who I am. That's the lens principle. Another one, who we are determines in what we see. Who we are determines in what we see. For instance, a man from Colorado moved to Texas. He goes to Texas. He builds a house with a very large picture window from which he could view hundreds and hundreds of miles down the range. When asked how he enjoyed the view, he says, "The only problem is that there's nothing to see." About the same time, a man from Texas moved to Colorado. He builds a house with a very large picture window in his living room, overlooking the Rockies. When they asked him how he liked it, he says, "Well, the only problem is with this place is you can't see anything because all those mountains in the way." Who he was determined how he saw things, all right? What people see is influenced by who they are. People in the same room will look at things, see the very same things that you and I see. For instance, if I were to ask you about this auditorium, all right, what do you see? Let's try this out. Let's go ahead and do this. All right, look at the auditorium. What do you see in this auditorium? I'm going to pick on somebody, and you tell me what you see. I'm going to pick on the music man. How do you see this auditorium, Mr. Music Man?
Well, it's beautiful, yeah.
Put him on the spot.
Well, I've already criticized this auditorium, so it's a problem.
All right. Never mind. All right, let me move on. Sherry. Terry. All right. Okay, let's stop right there. Floral, blue. All right. Let me pick on somebody else. Yeah, Bob. That thing is demon possessed. It goes on, it goes off. He sees a light that went out. All right, this is good. This is where I'm getting at. All right. Anybody else? Josh Johnson, what do you see? Okay, he sees the work that was done. Good. Let me pick a Sherry Henniger. Amen. This is excellent. This is proving my case. Very good. I probably should stop there, okay? What I was hoping the music guy would talk about was, you know, the speakers and this and that. But here's the thing. You see different people, they saw different things. We saw flowers and colors and everything that. And, we saw a light goes out. We saw work that's been done. We saw potential pews being filled. See, we saw different things. For instance, if a husband and wife were in a room full of people, the wife would ask a question to the husband. Did you see that guy over there that's dressed in the nice suit coat and classy shoes and all that? And the guy's husband says, no, what are you talking about? But did you notice the guy over there is well-built and muscular? See, they're seeing the same person through different lenses. It's because of who they are. One is more interested in dress, and the other is more interested in something else. But it's the lens principle. Who you are determines in how you see things. Let me give you a third thing. Who you are determines in how you view life, okay? An old story, and I've used this before, but an old story of a grandfather, he's sleeping on the couch, and as he's sleeping on the couch, his little grandson wants to play a trick on him. He goes to the refrigerator, he gets some of that Limburger cheese, and he kind of rubs it in his grandpa's mustache. And grandpa's laying there sleeping as a little kid sneaks around the corner. Grandpa all of a sudden sits way up, and man, something stinks in here. And the grandkid's snickering in the background. The guy goes in the kitchen, sniffs in the kitchen. He wants to get something. It stinks in here, too. He goes out to the back porch. He wants a breath of fresh air. He takes in a deep breath and starts coughing and hacking. Boy, the whole world stinks. It's his perception of stuff. You see, he's thinking everything else stinks, but the problem is not the whole world. The problem is his. All he's got to do is wash the cheese out of his mustache, and he'll be fine. But that goes back to the moral of the story is that unto the pure, all things are pure. Unto the defiled, all things are defiled. So how you view life, how you view people, is determined on who you really are on the inside. So being honest with yourself, how are you on the inside? All right? Before I get to the last part, let's continue on. You and I, we all have a frame of reference that consists of our attitudes, assumptions, expectations concerning ourselves and other people in life. These factors determine whether we're optimistic or pessimistic, cheerful or gloomy, trusting or suspicious, friendly or reserved, brave or timid. All these things color not only how we see life, but also how we let people treat us. You might let people in, you might keep them at arm's length. Eleanor Roosevelt said, "No one can make you feel inferior without your consent." I love that. You have to let them make you feel that way. Or put it another way, in the words of psychologist Phil McGraw, he said, "You teach people how to treat you." There's a lot more people that need to be here to hear this because that's true. You teach people how to treat you. For instance, think about this. How do people respond to you? Do they gather around you or do they make an escape when they see you coming? All right. Is it their fault? Or is it your fault? If you're in charge of a project, are there plenty of volunteers that want to be around you and help you? Or are you there by yourself working? Do people believe you when you say something, or do they question you? These are honest questions for each of us to evaluate. You say, "Preacher, that's tough," because I don't know, but maybe there's something in there that pertains to you. Well, that's okay. That's good, because God's speaking to your heart. He says, "We can change all that." We can, okay? If you find it offensive that no one wants to help you, most likely it's because you've trained them concerning you. You teach people how to treat you. What you teach comes from how you see life. and how you see life comes from who you are. And listen, I've had to learn this stuff myself in my own life a long time ago. You know, people didn't like being around me because I was a prankster as a kid. I was one of those annoying people that people got tired of picking on and the jokes and everything. But I learned the hard way, okay? And I learned that it's not always funny. You got to know where to draw the lines. And I stopped doing stuff like that because of the way I was. And so this is a good thing. Let me give you another one. Number four, who you are determines on what you do. Kenneth Tucker tells a story about of barnyard characters that's meant to point out how companies mismanage their people. Believing that anyone can be trained to do anything, those in charge of the farm, remember this is barnyard characters, they asked the workhorse to operate a computer. They asked the shy sheep to encourage them to make sale calls. And here's the favorite, a scarecrow was sent to the hen house to lay eggs. The poor scarecrow, he worked at it all day long. Physically, he exhibited perfect form. With all the hens around him cackling and cranking out egg after egg, he tries and he tries, but by the end of the day, he's exhausted and he has failed to produce a single egg. Now, we all know that hens lay eggs, horses pull plows, sheep produce wool, but our thinking and our attitude are as much as part of as our talents and abilities. They also determine what we do. We cannot separate them, and if we expect results different from our makeup, then we're in for a disappointment. Each of us have God-given talents that God has given us specifically, and we need to find that and get in there. Let me finish on here. Some people may have a great attitude, but they're limited because of their thinking. There are many verses that deal with our thinking. For instance, I've got several here. Let me just give you a couple of them. I'm going to read Proverbs 23, but everybody turn to Matthew chapter 5, and then also go to James chapter 1. You're already in James 3. Go over to James chapter 1. All right? Our thinking either makes us or breaks us. Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." All right? Jesus dealt with this same attitude here in Matthew chapter 5. Now, he goes on several illustrations, but I'm only going to share this one. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 27, Jesus said, ye have heard that it's been said of them by old, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman and lust after her in his heart, hath committed adultery already with her in his heart. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it before thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. The key is verse 28, where it says that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. The heart. He's talking about the thinking of the mind. What you dwell on in your mind, what you allow to go on in your mind, will eventually come out in action. I've shared stories of that, with men committing adultery, other things that take place. But it all takes place in the mind. What you let in the eye gate affects your thinking. What you let in the ear gate affects your thinking. So if you put garbage in, my friend, garbage is going to eventually come out. And it may come out through the mouth. It'll come out through action. But people are going to catch up on these things. And so don't let the garbage in. The idea is that sin begins in the mind. As it ruminates in the mind, it makes itself manifest through actions. The things people say, they do come out through things that they've already been thinking on and meditating on. Now, James chapter 1, verse 13, God points out that all of our action and words come from within us. They are a product of who we are and who we've become. He says in verse 13, "Let no man say he is tempted of God, or when he is tempted, that I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." Notice this. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. That word lust means desires. Desires of the heart, because he's been thinking about it. Stuff that are here. All right, drawn away of his own lust. Then it says, and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. That's the action. And sin, when it's finished, bringeth forth death. It destroys you, okay? So it starts in the heart. It starts in the mind. You let it in here. It comes in. It's conceived in the mind. It ruminates. You meditate upon it. And then later on, Satan will make sure. He knows what's in there. He's going to make sure that he entices that thing that he's been helping you meditate on for a very, very long time. And once that enticement comes, it's going to produce a sin, and action follows it. Whether it's not the end result sin that brings ruin to your life, but it may be a series of steps of sins. This little sin produces this sin. Oh, it's not a big deal. I can manage this. Produces another sin. Then the ultimate sin that just destroys your marriage and everything else. That's what he's talking about. It always comes out. It ruminates. It meditates. And so here we are. Who you are determines what you do, because you are what you are on the inside. That's what salvation's about as well, is because you allow Jesus to come in. But that's on the other side of the coin. So he's saying, you're not tempted of God. Don't even say you're tempted of God. Your temptations come from what's in here and what's in here, what's in the mind. And so the lens principle shows us that we evaluate others, we view others, we treat others, we make actions upon who we really are on the inside. You say, well, preacher, if you only knew what I was really like in the inside. Well, guess what? We're all flesh, aren't we? God can change all of that. If you don't like who you are, then all you got to do is change your lenses. You say, what do you mean? Well, first of all, salvation is necessary. If you're already saved, great, you're on the right track. If you're not saved, then you need to get saved, because that puts you on the right track. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. That word creature means creation. A metamorphosis takes place. Something changes within that person. We call it the spiritual birth in John chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 6. You must be born again. It's a spiritual birth. It's the change, the new man. Then he says, old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. You take these lenses off, you put new lenses on. All right? And some people go back into the old sins, and God's not pleased with that. All right? Go with me to, I got several here. Let me give you Philippians 1:6. Turn there. Philippians 1:6 and Romans 12. Philippians 1:6. While you're there, let me read one from Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13:20 says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. One of the things, through salvation, Jesus Christ, his goal, he looks at you differently than what you used to be. You were a sinner, lost, condemned on your way to hell. Now you're saved by the grace of God. You're a child of God. His desire is to make you perfect. You're on the road to perfection. He's given you an about face. Another thing that helps us is the work of God. Here in Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, this true thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you, I love this, will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. In other words, he's not going to stop. He begun the good work. When did he start it? At salvation. He's taken you from wherever you're at. He's put you on a solid rock. He says, I'm going to finish this work. I'm going to complete it. Sometimes we may get stagnant for a while. Maybe we'll be in the wrong place, the wrong time, whatever. And then he takes us, and we got the right desires, and he puts us where we need to be. He turns us around. He says, but then he says, I will perform it. I will do that work in their heart. I will never leave them. I will never forsake them. I will continue to work on them. And the other thing here, Romans chapter 12, here's a verse I want you to claim, memorize it, mark it down. This is a promise from God too. Romans chapter 12, verse 1, that word beseech means implore or beg. I beseech of you, brethren, I beg of you, brethren, by the mercies of God, notice this, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. Don't wait till you're dead and gone. Don't wait till you're retired. Do it right now, wherever you're at, this stage of life. Doesn't matter what you've done before. Here you are at this stage of life. Give yourself to God right now while you're still alive, a living sacrifice, holy. That means you might not be holy, but you're trying. You're going to live for God. You keep falling down, but get back up. The Bible says in Proverbs, a just man may fall down, but he gets back up, all right? And so on. He says, a living sacrifice, holy, not what's acceptable to man, but what's acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. In other words, that's the least you can do for God. What has God done for you? Preacher, you saved me from hell. I may live 100 years from in my lifetime, but when I die, I'm going to heaven. I'm not going to hell. I'll live for all of eternity in the presence of God. I'll walk the streets of gold. I'll walk in the kingdom of heaven for the rest of eternity. Man, isn't that worth something? He says, this is your reasonable service. It's the least we can do for God. And then what has he done for us in this lifetime? Even if we were Lazarus, the man that was sick, that laid at the rich man's gates, having sores, and the dogs would lick his sores every day and just eat the crumbs, he still went to heaven when he died. Even if it's a miserable life, we still get to go to heaven. But other than that, what else has he done? He forgave me of my sins. He's given me hope. He's taken this backward person that I am, and he's turned me around and given me confidence that I never had before. He's given me about face. He put things back together in my life. Well, that's something. Verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. The world wants you to put it in its mold, right? The way it thinks, what it does, what it believes. Well, we believe in this. You can pick whichever bathroom you want to go into. No, that's the world's thinking. I will not allow my mind to be conformed to the world's thinking. Men marry men, women marry men. No, I'm not going to conform to this world. That is wrong. It's not godly. God calls it an abomination. Well, lying is all right to get the job done. Lying is okay in politics and in business. No, it's not. I will do right, and God will bless you tremendously. Be not conformed to this world. But then it says, but be transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Okay, the renewing of the mind. How do we renew that mind? Think about it for a minute. I mentioned this early. G-I-G-O. Giggo. Garbage in, garbage out. So if I put garbage in my mind, garbage is going to come out of my life. But if I put good in my mind, eventually good will come out. You change your thinking. How do I change my thinking? First of all, you already got a changed heart because you're saved. You've already got the presence of the Holy Spirit. You're sealed with the Spirit because you're saved. That's a great thing. Stop thinking about the things you used to think about. Go to bed. Read your Bible before you go to bed if that's what you have to do. Read it. Say, I don't read well. Then listen to it on your iPod or something. Listen to the Bible. Let that be the last things you think about before you go to bed. And you know what? You know what? I've told this before, and I've experienced this. People who listen to a lot of rock music and everything, when you get saved and you get that garbage out of your mouth, out of your life, you need to change your thinking. What happens? You get in the Bible. You listen to Christian music. You get in the Bible. Listen to the preaching. What happens is that all that stuff is going to fight back. You might experience, I experienced nightmares for a while. Some terrible, terrible dreams. You see, why is it? Because my brain is getting rid of it. The old is coming out. It's being replaced with something good. You know, G-I-G-O, garbage in, garbage out, so put the good in. Listen to good Bible preaching. Listen to good Christian music. Don't participate in the filthy language of the world. Somebody tells a dirty joke, say, I don't want to hear that garbage. That's wrong. You say, they don't like it. It doesn't matter if they don't like it. They shouldn't have told it. You know, they shouldn't have done it. You don't have to listen to that garbage, all right? And so you renew your mind. Get into the Word of God. Saturate your mind with good. Saturate it with good music. Saturate it with the Word of God. Spend time on your knees praying to God. Let that take you over, all right? And you know what? Your thinking will change. It may take time. And yes, you're going to stumble and fall now and then. That's all right. You're a just man. Get back up and keep on going. And your thinking will change. But it's not going to be wrong thinking. It's going to be right thinking. It's going to be powerful thinking. It's going to be wise thinking. Because that's what God wants. Amen? Let me give you some suggestions. You say, where do I start? Well, get you one of the Bible reading schedules that we have. It's got all the books of the Bible. It's got every chapter and a little square box for every chapter that you read. X out that box. Secondly, memorize Scripture. You get a verse like Romans 12, 1 and 2. Put it on a 3x5 card. Pull it out of your pocket. Read it. Put it back in your pocket. Think about that throughout the day. Try to read in the Bible Proverbs a day. Today, I believe today's the 28th. Read the 28th chapter of Proverbs. If today is the 7th day of the month, read the 7th chapter. If it's the 5th day of the month, read the 5th chapter of Proverbs. Say, why? Proverbs is a book of wisdom. It teaches you how to act. It teaches you how to speak. It teaches you verses like, the fool uttereth all his mind, but a wise man keeps it in till afterwards. Even a fool can be counted as wise if he shuts his mouth. Boy, those are good verses to memorize, aren't they? And so, talks about not casting your pearls before swine. Be careful what you say. Put a guard about your mouth. You know, read a Proverbs a day. Read in the Gospels. Read John. Read Romans. And then from there you can spread out. Some people start at Genesis. I don't advise that. And go through all of the Bible to get to the end. Now, very few people that have done that and stayed, you know, they stayed in church and everything else. But they were bent and determined they're going to read it through. Wonderful. But start with some of the Psalms and the Proverbs and John and Romans, then Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Get in the Bible, read. One of the easiest and shortest Gospels, you got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Read Mark. It's short. Get to where you accomplish something. Get into the Word of God and let it become a part of you. He says, by the mercies of God, you present yourself a living sacrifice. That's how it starts. Where you have to come to the place where you say, God, whatever I am left, I'm yours. You know what God's going to do? He says, I'll take you. But Lord, I got this perverted stuff going on in my mind. He says, that's all right, I'll take you the way you are. God, I've got these flaws in my life. I've got sin scars all over me. He says, that's all right. By the mercies of God, I'll take you. I'll show you mercy. I'll take you how you are, where you're at, but I'm not taking you to leave you where you're at. But I'm going to turn you around, and I'm going to build you up. I'm going to do that good work. And that's what God wants to do with all of us. That's what he wants to do. And so keep that in mind. By the mercies of God, present yourself to God as a living sacrifice where you say, God, I'm yours. If you've not done that, let me challenge you to do that tonight, all right? When you go home,